I have been standing in front of audiences for 30 years talking about drugs. And I often start my presentations with an apology. Specifically, I apologize for the lies of past drug educators, including myself. And I acknowledge that we've told three lies. We've exaggerated the harms of drugs, we've never acknowledged the benefits of drugs, and we've never talked about the dominant model for controlling drugs in our society, which is drug prohibition, which has failed us all so badly. Now, for much of my career, I've talked about that last point, talk about the failure of the war on drugs, but today I'm going to talk about the benefits of drugs. Specifically, I'm going to talk about psychedelics. Now, psychedelics have been around in human culture since before recorded human history, and we can see at least four communities, cultures today, that have woven the psychedelic experience into the fabric of their culture. There's the curanderos use of psilocybin mushrooms, there's the ayahuasca use in the Amazon basin, there's the huicho use of peyote, and the shamanic use of Amanita muscaria in Siberia. Now, on the surface, how the container of safety is created with these cultures, with this psychedelic experience, is all different. But if you look at how the experience is integrated into the culture, it's actually quite similar. They're used for healing. Everything from psychological to physical issues. They're used for celebration of transitions, everything from seasonal changes to puberty rites. And they're used for spirituality, to connect the individuals and the culture to the cosmos as a whole. If I wanted to use one word to describe that, what I would say is the word would be pro-social. Psychedelics have always been used to connect people to their culture and to the universe. So it was historically unprecedented what happened in the 1960s when psychedelics got linked to an antisocial message. It had never happened before. Tim Leary said, tune in, turn on, and drop out. And the subsequent social backlash has caused immense human suffering, and it goes on today. Now, admittedly, there were some other cultural issues going on at the time, but certainly that disconnect's message was profound. And the media participated in the spinning of the web of illusions. LSD-fed ape rapes TV actress. LSD made me a prostitute. Girl gives birth to frog. And even the science of the time was suppressed. For 40 years, scientists couldn't do what they needed to do, which is measure stuff. Now, can I think of any other time in human history when science has either been suppressed or criminalized? Well, as a matter of fact, I can. In 1616, and then for the subsequent 143 years, the science of the telescope was banned. It was illegal for people to report what they saw through the lens of the telescope, specifically that the Earth was not the center of the universe. LSD is to the study of the mind what the telescope is to astronomy and what the microscope is to biology, according to Stanislav Grof. Well, psychedelics are back. This is the Canadian Medical Association Journal, the conservative voice of Canadian medicine, with a number of articles exploring the psychedelic renaissance, the explosion of research that's happened in recent years. And that's really what I want to talk to you about. But to be really clear, what I'm talking about here is skilled, trained, competent professionals using pure substances in ways that are well supervised. I'm not talking about impure street drugs used by unsupervised, irresponsible adolescents. So how do researchers think about psychedelics these days? Because they break them into three categories. The first are the classics, LSD, mescaline, dimethyltryptamine, and psilocybin. And these offer researchers a variety of attributes that are worthy of investigation. For example, spirituality. Now, it's kind of neutral spirituality because Buddhists find the Buddha, Christians find Christ, and atheists and agnostics find the entire universe. And this particular aspect of these medicines is quite useful for situations like end-of-life anxiety. When we are dying and we're anxious about the experience and we take a dosage of psilocybin and we meet our maker and we're told it's okay, we can relax, we're just coming home, it tends to reduce the stress of that transition. The classical psychedelics also offer a disorientation of the ego, which can be very helpful in things like treatment for alcoholism. They also increase the permeability between the unconscious and the conscious mind. They allow us to have access to our unconscious in a way that we don't normally. Now, if you really think about the human experience, a lot of our lives are lived unconsciously. For example, driving a car. Our conscious mind is thinking about the radio and what we're going to have for lunch and the conflict we had with our spouse or whatever. We don't think about our feet. Our unconscious mind is driving the car. We live our lives with lots of tape loops that just happen automatically. And if something bad happened to us in childhood and it's replaying itself consistently in our adult life and causing problems for us, it's very hard to access because it's unconscious. Psychedelics can help with that. Psychedelics also offer, the classic psychedelics offer what I call the portal effect, which is the, wow, that was incredible effect. It's a bit like climbing Mount Everest or graduating high school. You have a sense of accomplishment and transition. And that's very helpful in many conditions. The second group of psychedelics are the empathogens. 3-MMC, MDA, MDMA are examples. And what they do is they bond people and increase empathy. And that's really useful to bond a therapist to somebody who wants some help. That connection is really important. It could be facilitated with these medicines. They also take away fear. So if a soldier who's been in battle in Afghanistan comes back to North America and is replaying that trauma again and again, normal therapy can't access it, partly because it's unconscious, but partly because if anything that gets close to it has a huge fear response. And MDMA specifically takes away that fear and allows the tape to be reworked. It appears that MDMA-assisted psychotherapy may be the best treatment for PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, that exists. And then there's everything else, things like ibogaine, which appear to be incredibly helpful for heroin withdrawals, opiate addiction. There's 2CB, there's salvia, and there's ketamine that seems to be helpful for depression. Now, my own area of academic interest is articulating post-prohibition models for the regulation and control of all currently illegal drugs based on public health principles. You might have noticed drug prohibition is slowly crumbling under the weight of its own ineffectiveness. It does not protect our communities. It does not protect our families, and it does not protect our children. So it will end. And I ask the question, what are we going to replace it with, peering through the lens of public health? So the goal of a public health approach is to maximize the benefits and minimize the harms. Now, I've already talked about some benefits, so I'd like to talk about harms. The harms from all drugs can be broken into three categories: dependency, toxicity, and behavior. Dependency. I worked for the addiction services for 30 years. Nobody ever walked in my office saying, "I can't stop taking LSD." It never happened. So the dependency potential for psychedelics is really low. Toxicity. The last time you took a prescription drug, if you took 6 times the dosage, you probably did yourself harm. That 1-to-6 ratio is very common for most drugs. With LSD, it's in the thousands. In fact, Albert Hoffman, who invented LSD, said it was one of the least toxic substances on the planet. So dependency is very low, toxicity is very low. So all of the harms from psychedelics come from one thing, which is the behavior, which is essentially lack of supervision. Now, indigenous communities have known this for years. They've always provided the experience in a very tight container of safety where they're highly supervised experiences. How researchers are thinking about this today is they think about the words, or they talk about the words, set, which is expectations, setting, which is the environment, dosage, which is what you take and how much, and safety, which is the umbrella term. So set, setting, safety, and dosage are carefully structured by the research community today. So in a post-prohibition world, if the goal is to maximize the benefits and minimize the harms of psychedelics, people would have access to the psychedelic experience, so long as they were supervised. There was a container of safety built around the experience, and somebody was in charge, a trained, competent, skilled professional who was licensed would be allowed to offer the experiences to others so long as set, setting, dosage, and safety were managed. And it wouldn't matter what the environment was. It could be indigenous healing circles. It could be psychedelic psychotherapy. It could be multi-day dance festivals. It doesn't matter, as long as somebody is in charge. I would like to reflect on the human predicament today. We're in trouble as a species. Global climate change is affecting all of us. There's a concentration of wealth at the top of the pile that is unprecedented in any society. So few people control so much wealth. There's a huge amount of violence and religious extremism. And we live in these really strange societies where somehow we've equated happiness with buying stuff. So if I really think about those problems, they're problems of disconnection. We are disconnected from the earth. We are disconnected from each other. We are disconnected from a true sense of meaning and purpose in our lives, and we're disconnected from healthy spiritual experiences. The good news is psychedelics are all about connections. These two images are very powerful. They're depictions of the human brain based on neuroscience. The one on the left is the normal human brain. The parts of the outside of the circle are the different parts of the human brain, the visual cortex, for example. Notice that the visual cortex talks a lot to the visual cortex and not a lot to the other parts of the brain. The image on the right is the human brain under the influence of psilocybin. Notice the rich range of new connections that are formed. Psychedelics are all about connections. Connections with self. We have access to our unconscious minds in a way we do not normally have access to. Connections with each other. That's the empathogen research. Connections with a sense of meaning and purpose to life. There's a lot of research done on that. And connections with a sense of true spirituality. Indigenous communities have known that for centuries. I Isaac Asimov said, one of the saddest aspects of life now is that science gathers knowledge faster than society gathers wisdom. We, as a human species, need to grow up. We need to take advantage of and learn and work with the knowledge that we already have. And perhaps, just perhaps, something that could help us mature as a species and maybe even assist with our survival is mature, skillful, wise use of psychedelic medicines. Thank you.